So the mother is RH negative. Now, how much is the incidence of RH negative pregnancy? The incidence of RH negative pregnancy is about 5 to 10%. 5 to 10%. Now the genotypes. Genotypes is the RH factor is a complex antigen comprising of three sets. It is total six of allelomorphic genes. That is capital D small d, capital C small c, and capital E small e, carried on a pair of chromosomes. The D antigen is the most potent. Its presence or absence denotes an individual to be RH positive or negative. Now, if the father is homozygous, RH positive, that is capital D, and when carrying capital D only, that is capital D and small d, in one set, it is called as heterozygous. So in the homozygous, the fetus being RH positive is 100%, while heterozygous it is 50%. Now, what is alloimmunization and methods of isoimmunization? Alloimmunization is defined as production of immune antibodies in an individual. In response to foreign red cell antigen derived from other individual of the same species. Provided the first one lacks the antigen. RH isoimmunization occurs in the following conditions. The first is transfusion of mismatched blood, which is rare today. And second is pregnancy in RH positive fetus. The normal fetal RBCs cannot mix with maternal blood. This can happen in certain conditions when in case of abortion, in case of abortion of more than 7 weeks, abortion of more than 7 weeks. Next is antepartum hemorrhage, antepartum hemorrhage. Next is amniocentesis. Next is amniocentesis. Next, external cephalic version. External cephalic version. Then at delivery. At delivery during the third stage. During the third stage. Next is caesarean section. Caesarean section. And the last is manual removal of the placenta. Manual removal of the placenta. Then also it occurs in ectopic. Ectopic. Then chorion-villus sampling. Chorion-villus sampling. Then choroidosynthesis. Choroidosynthesis. And abdominal trauma. And abdominal trauma. At least 0.1 ml of the fetal blood, 0.1 ml of fetal blood is required for immunization. Mechanism of antibody formation. Rh positive cells that enter the circulation remain there till their lifespan. Next point, then they are removed by reticuloendothelial system and liberate antigen. The types of antibodies seen are IgM antibodies and IgG antibodies. IgM antibodies are large molecules. They don't cross the placenta and do not damage the fetus. Next is IgG antibodies. IgG antibodies, as they are small molecules, they cross the placenta and they damage the fetus. Now, mechanism of affection. Next heading, mechanism of affection. First is the antibody gets attached to the fetal RBC antigen sites. Second point, these RBCs are considered abnormal and removed from the circulation by reticuloendothelial system. Next point, depending upon the degree of destruction, the following pathologies are seen. The first is Hydrops fetalis. Second, Icterus gravis neonatorum. And the third one is congenital anemia of the newborn. Now we will discuss one by one the pathology seen. The first is hydrops fetalis. Head hospital is, it is most serious form of RH hemolytic disease. There is excess destruction of the fetal red cells, which lead to severe anemia, tissue anoxemia, and metabolic acidosis. Next point, there is hyperplasia of the placental tissue. In effort to increase the transfer of oxygen, but available fetal red cells are diminished due to hemolysis. Now, next point, fetal death occurs sooner or later due to cardiac failure. Now we will discuss the diagnostic features of hydrospitalis. The first point, mother is RH negative. Second point, on the serological examination, RH antibody is seen. Third is presence of polyhydramnios. Fourth point, previous history of affection of the baby due to hemolytic disease. Next point, ultrasound examination to detect edema in the skin, scalp, and pleural or pericardial effusion and echogenic bowel. Next point, straight X-ray abdomen shows Buddha position of the fetus with a halo. Next point, baby at birth looks pale and edematous with enlarged abdomen due to ascites. There is enlargement of the liver and spleen. Placenta. Next point, placenta is large, pale, and edematous with fluid oozing from it. The weight is increased to almost of the fetal weight. Undue persistence of the Langhans layer with marked swelling of the villi are seen. Now the second disorder, which is called as icterus gravis neonatorum. The baby is born alive without evidence of jaundice, but it develops within 24 hours after birth. See, this is a form of pathological jaundice. So it is developing within 24 hours. Now the pathology. Now the pathology is when the fetus is in utero, there is destruction of fetal red cells with liberation of unconjugated bilirubin, which is mostly excreted through the placenta into maternal system. A portion of the bilirubin enters amniotic fluid, perhaps through the fetal lung or skin, and process the placenta and the cord. So the baby is not born with jaundice. But as soon as the umbilical cord is clamped with containing hemolysis, the bilirubin concentration is increased. So sooner or later, the baby is jaundiced with main problem in the liver. If bilirubin level goes to more than 20, there is risk of developing carnic tears. Then the last is the congenital anemia of the newborn. The first point is, there are only three points. First is mildest form of the disease. Second point is destruction of the red cells. It continues up to 6 weeks, after which antibodies are not available for hemolysis. And the last point is liver and spleen are enlarged which are the sites of extramedullary erythropoiesis. Now, how to prevent isoimmunization? We have one drug which is called as anti-D, that is Rh anti-D immunoglobulin. It is administered intramuscular to the mother following childbirth within 72 hours if the baby is Rh positive. The dose is 300 micrograms following delivery. And into bracket you write one more point, 50 micrograms following abortion. Now the mechanism of action of anti-D, how does it act? Anti-D immunoglobulins surround the fetal RBCs and block antigenic sites, thus preventing its expression and sensitization of maternal immune system. Now the second point is to prevent or to minimize fetal maternal bleed. Now what precautions you will take? 5 points are there. The first point, precautions during a cesarean section dash to prevent the blood spill in the peritoneal cavity. Comma, you allow the placenta to separate on its own. Okay, comma, no manual removal of the placenta, into bracket to write MRP. If at all MRP is required, it should be done gently with gentle handling of the uterus. Second point is no prophylactic ergometrine at the delivery of anterior shoulder. Third point, amniocentesis is to be done after ultrasonic localization of the placenta. Fourth point is the forcible attempts to perform external cephalic version under general anesthesia must be avoided. And the last point is to refrain from abdominal palpation in abruptio placenta. Now, and next point is to avoid mismatch transfusion. Now this point is rare nowadays. Now, how will you investigate this mother? If you see the patient in the OPD for the first time. Now, mandatory investigations, you send everything. That is, you send a complete blood count. You send the blood group. You do HIV antigen test. Then you look for the thyroid profile. You look for the blood sugar levels and urine examination at the first visit. Now the blood group is most important. Blood group and Rh factor typing. Now, if you know that the mother is Rh negative, you get her husband's blood group also done. Now, the second point is. A detailed obstetric history in case of multigravida and whether she has received NTD injections previously in the antenatal period or after delivery, that is also important. Now the next point is next investigation is indirect Coombs test. Next is Doppler ultrasound, amniocentesis, and the points for the fetal well-being assessment. Now if ICT or the indirect Coombs test is negative, you manage like non-immunized mother. If indirect Coombs test is positive, you manage the patient like immunized mother. Now, Now what exactly I want to tell you, like non-immunized mother and immunized mother. If the mother is non-immunized, then do first husband's blood group. Husband's blood group, if the husband's blood group is negative, then there is no need of any further evaluation. Now if the husband's blood group is positive, then you have to repeat the indirect Coombs test. Repeat the indirect Coombs test at 28 weeks. And you again check for the results. If it is negative, you give 300 micrograms of NTD to the mother. If ICT is positive, you manage her like an immunized mother. Now the second point. If ICT is negative at 28 weeks, then deliver the baby, at term. Now, some important points. First is, take the measures to reduce fetal maternal hemorrhage. Next point, immediate cord clamping. Next point, keep the cord long. The length should be 15 to 20 centimeters. Now, fourth point, blood grouping, serum bilirubin, hemoglobin percent, then direct Coombs test, and manage accordingly. Next point, if the baby is Rh positive and DCT negative, give injection NTD to the mother, within 72 hours. The injection NTD should be 300 micrograms. And last important sentence, if this policy is followed, it will reduce isoimmunization in more than 90% cases. Now, if the mother is immunized, then what to do? The first point, if ICT positive, do it every four weeks. ICT titer every 4 weeks. See that it does not cross critical level. The critical titer varies from 1:8 to 1:32. Into bracket you write. The common is 1:16. Next line, when titer is more than 1:8, you consider amniocentesis. Now the amniocentesis, the indications are, if antibody titers exceed the critical level. Next point, when there is a sudden rise in antibody titer, in antibody titer, even though it is below or at the critical level, or at the critical level. And last point, if there is history of, if there is history of previous, previous neonatal death, neonatal death, 10 weeks, then it is done. I'm sorry, it is done 10 weeks prior to that gestational age. Prior to that gestational age. Amniocentesis is done. Amniocentesis is done at 26 weeks. At 26 weeks under local anesthesia. Under local anesthesia. By taking aseptic, aseptic precautions, precautions. It is usually done, it is usually done under ultrasonic guidance, under ultrasonic guidance. As the placental localization is a must, a spinal needle of 22 gauge, of 22 gauge is used and about, about 5 to 10 ml, about 5 to 10 ml of amniotic fluid, of amniotic fluid is taken for spectrophotometric analysis, spectrophotometric analysis. And the management on amniotic fluid analysis, management is based on amniotic fluid analysis, where it is seen on the Lilly's chart. Lilly's chart, there are three zones. First is zone 1, second is zone 2, and the last is zone 3. Zone 1 stands for, zone 1 stands for non-affected, non-affected or mildly affected fetus, or mildly affected fetus, where you can repeat the testing at 4 weeks, where you can repeat the testing at 4 weeks and deliver at term, and deliver at term. In zone 2, which is moderate to severely affected, repeat the test after 1 week. Repeat the test after 1 week and look for the results. See if it is at zone 2 lower side, zone 2 lower side, repeat at 2 to 3 weeks, repeat at 2 to 3 weeks. If it is on the higher side, repeat at 1 week, repeat at 1 week. And zone 3, zone 3 stands for a severely affected fetus, severely affected fetus. The fetus may die, the fetus may die in 7 to 10 days, in 7 to 10 days if no treatment is given, if no treatment is given. If it is more than 34 weeks, more than 34 weeks, plan for delivery, and if it is less than 34 weeks, less than 34 weeks, then do choldocentesis, do choldocentesis. Now, how is choldocentesis done? How is choldocentesis done? First is location of the placenta, location of the placenta. And also the insertion of the cord, also the insertion of the cord. Now if the placenta is anterior, if the placenta is anterior or lateral, anterior or lateral, transplacental, transplacental insertion of the needle, transplacental insertion of the needle. If it is posterior, transaminitic insertion, and the cord is punctured, close to placental insertion, and the complications which can arise during choroidocentesis are abortion, preterm labor, and rise in antibody levels, comma, fetal exsanguination, bradycardia of the fetus, and failure of the procedure. Now, role of ultrasound is, it is important to detect fetal gestational age, and fetal well-being assessment. Now, the diagnostic features in affected pregnancy are polyhydramnios, fetal ascites, pericardial effusion, hepatosplenomegaly, placentomegaly, and dilated umbilical veins. Now, Doppler. What does Doppler show? Increased peak velocity in the middle cerebral artery, in anemic fetus. Now, the cardiotocography is done from 28 weeks onwards. Put this slide like that. Are you booked here? No number yet, I said. Now the modes of delivery are vaginal delivery in mildly affected cases, and near term in moderate and severely affected fetus. Cesarean section is done. In vaginal delivery, continuous monitoring of the fetus is feasible. No oxytocin, due to the risk of fetal hyperbilirubinemia. Then keep the blood bags ready in case transfusion is required, and breastfeeding to the fetus is allowed. Now, what is exchange transfusion in the newborn? Methods of blood transfusion in the fetus are intrauterine transfusion, which includes intraperitoneal and intravascular transfusion. Second is plasmapheresis. The third is high dose intravenous immunoglobulins, and the last is exchange transfusion in the newborn. Now I will talk on exchange transfusion in the newborn. Exchange transfusion, the indications are the cord hemoglobin is less than 12. Cord hemoglobin is less than 12, then DCT is positive. DCT is positive and the cord bilirubin is more than 5. Late, it is done for hyperbilirubinemia. And what are the aims? It treats anemia. Second, it washes IgG antibodies out. And the last is, it removes the bilirubin. Now the procedure. It is done in special NICU. Second point, exchanged blood should be Rh negative or O negative. Third, route of transfusion is umbilical vein in early transfusion. For late transfusions, femoral route or saphenous vein are preferred. Next point, airtight set, which is to be periodically flushed with heparinized saline to prevent the clotting. Then the next point, 15 ml of the blood, 1/5 of the blood is withdrawn and 10 ml is pushed. The amount is 160 to 180 ml per kg body weight. And then you have to estimate the hemoglobin and bilirubin concentration after transfusion. And antibiotics are given for 5 days. Now the next heading is post transfusion care. 3 points are there. 4 points. The baby is placed in a warm cot. Second, you inspect the umbilicus for the bleeding. Third, the serum bilirubin is estimated every 6 hours after transfusion. And the last point is the correction of hypoglycemia. Now, indications of repeat exchange transfusion. First, if bilirubin rises to more than 20, and second is if the hemoglobin falls to 15 gram per cent.